Okay, recording. We are talking about fugues today. Sorry I can't be there to go over this with you, but we'll be able to get it just fine. So here is a link to that Wikipedia page that I showed you guys, and really all you need to read through is from musical outline below. The main key points to understand is this one right here, exposition and episode development. Okay, those are kind of the three main terms. Within the exposition is going to be this word right there, bam, the subject. Now, how do you find the subject of a fugue? It's pretty easy. Let's take a look at this one. You have a link to this PDF also in Canvas. This is the A flat major Bach fugue. Notice here we have up a fifth, then there's that triad, and then it continues. And then right here, it's the same rhythm, but it's slightly different. Sometimes the answer, as it said in the reading, has to be altered to fit harmonically. But rhythmically and contour-wise, it's the same. So how do you know how long the subject is? This is kind of really weird, but you start with the first note of the subject, and then you correlate to that to the first note of the answer, and you just follow it along until you see where the answer deviates from the subject, and that's how you know how long the subject is. Okay, I know that was really confusing. So let me show you. Is that highlight? That's highlight. Okay, so definitely the subject is going to be, I'll put the subject in blue and the answer in green. Definitely the subject is going to be at least as long as, you know, up until when the answer enters. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 eighth notes, a quarter note, and then all these 16th notes. Well, here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 eighth notes. We don't have the quarter note. More eighth notes continue. So that's the subject right there. It's those six eighth notes. That's a little odd. Usually there's overlap. In this particular fugue, there isn't any overlap. So don't assume that the subject is only as long as until the answer comes in. I'll say that one more time. Usually there is overlap. This fugue is a little bit odd that there is no overlap. So now if we know that the subject is just 6 eighth notes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, there's the answer, okay? So now we're going to look, and this is what we call the exposition. So if I could, where's text? Exposition, okay? And the exposition is when we hear the subject and the answer in complete form. What is this? This is called the counter subject, all right? I just call it gobbledygook. It's like extra stuff, but there is a technical term for it. Now, right here, we have to determine, is this subject or answer? No, I don't think it is. It's just stuff, okay? So when there's just stuff, that's called the development. Then when the subject returns, then that is, let me go back here, that's this term, another episode. So if we go up to this diagram, we had the exposition, okay? Oh shoot, am I getting that wrong? An episode, well, what are they calling the development? Stupid. Further entries. Okay, sorry, ignore what I just said. So an episode is what separates the different entries of the subject. So if I go back to our A flat piece, there's there, all right. I'm gonna bounce around to the YouTube video so we can listen to it and see it at the same time. What we're looking for is, when does the subject return? There's the subject in the left hand now. This is all gobbledygook, intermittent stuff. There's the subject in the right hand. Hear that? So if I go back And we heard the subject, which we are going to do in blue. Sacré. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's the subject in the right hand. And now look, the answer. Bam. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Is right there in that voice. We double check the other voices to see if they have any, the subject or the answer, and they do not. So if I try to do this by sight, not by listening, I'm looking for that contour of 6 consecutive eighth notes, right? So we had, there's the statement number 1, then we have an episode where it's just gobbledygook, then we have statement number 2, entry number 2 of subject and answer. Now it's gobbledygook again, and at some point the subject is going to need to come back. I'm looking for 6 eighth notes in a row that would represent the subject. And I don't see them. The next time I see them, maybe I might be missing one. We'll come back and listen. The next time I see them is right there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then the answer, this is where Bach gets nice and fun. I suppose you could argue that's the answer right there, even though the contour is opposite. Because then we have it again right here, opposite contour. And let's see if we have it here somewhere. I don't see it. Oh, there it is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. So now I'm just going to keep looking for where do we get those 6 again? When are they going to come back? And bam, right there in the weird middle voices. See that? It crosses between treble and bass clef. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now we should expect to see it in a different voice. Bam, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then we get kind of episodic material, just gobbledygook, blah, 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 blah. And there we have it again. This is the opposite contour. Subject, answer, opposite contour. There it is. These are like little pieces now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. And there it is again, right there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The answer is going to be right there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Keep looking. This is another episode. Gobbledygook, gobbledygook, and bam. There it is right there. And where is the answer? It's going to be in this other voice. If you can kind of see it, that G, C, A flat, F, D, B natural. Okay, here it is again, right there. Here's the answer right here. Good news is that fugues generally follow a set formula once you figure out what the subject is and what the answer is. The whole thing is laid out. So then this is just kind of like an ending coda. You might have little bits and pieces of the subject and the answer. Okay, so now let's listen to it and see if I got them all. Let me go back to where it started. And I'm actually going to follow along on Cammy. Okay, subject. Answer. Episode. Middle ground stuff. There's the subject. Answer. Episodic material. Hear how prominently the performer plays that. Answer. Subject. Answer. Thank you. episode. Here comes. Subject. Answer. Hear that sequence in there? Oh, we missed one. It's right there. Kind of little four nuggets. It's kind of like pieces of the subject. There's another sequence. This is all just little motivic fragments to the end. We don't hear the whole subject. There's another little fragment. So the thing about fugues is I always thought they were like terrible to listen to. They're boring and they just go on forever. But once you understand the form, then you know what you're listening for, and it can actually, I don't know, I think it's kind of interesting and fun, like a puzzle. And in the episodes, I don't know if you noticed, but usually the motivic material is gonna be different than the subject. Notice that the subject is all eighth notes. And this material in the episodes is like 16th notes. And the subject is disjunct motion, whereas the material in the episode is conjunct motion. That's pretty typical. Also, we heard several sequences there during the episodes. And that, again, I said last class, sequences are often used for transition material. Last thing we need to do is to look at keys. So I'm going to go to my text box. Where's text box? Text box. And we start out in the key of A flat. Okay, it's called Fugue in A flat. One thing I should state is that Bach wrote, this is what's from something called, here, I'll write it up here so you can see it, the well-tempered clavier. So the clavier is a piano-like instrument. It's not a harpsichord. It's not a piano. It's kind of an in-between instrument. The piano wasn't invented yet. And then tempered has to do with the system of tuning. So just intonation or real intonation is when you use the tunings found in nature. The problem is, and this is where it gets into physics, you just need to trust me, it's kind of funky, and it doesn't work for the piano. So for the piano, or in this case, the clavier or the harpsichord, they had to cheat the tuning system in order to be able to play in more than one key. You could make a perfectly tuned piano for one key, but it was not able to be flexible to play in other keys and still be in tune. So what they did is they tempered it. They spread out the inconsistencies of tuning to make it so that the piano could be diverse and play in all keys. That's still how our pianos are today. Our pianos are tempered. So if a choir is singing with a piano, they tune slightly differently than if they're singing a cappella. You can just go ahead and Google that and read up all about it on your free time. It's kind of pretty fascinating and nerdy, or it's really boring and you don't want to have anything to do with it. So it's up to you. But the reason I bring this up is because it's probably one of Bach's most famous things, is that he wrote one fugue and one what's called a prelude in every key, and he did it twice. So there's Well-Tempered Clavier Book 1, Well-Tempered Clavier Book 2, and these books are still used today by piano students. If you play the piano, I can almost guarantee you've played a prelude or a fugue from this book. They're that, you know, they're just 300 years later, they're still being used. Okay, keys, A flat major. Remember what I said is you look for accidentals and then you look to see if the accidentals stick around. The nice part about a fugue is that oftentimes in the episodes, the keys change, so that then when we get the re-entry of the subject, it's in a new key. So you're gonna, so this is all A flat major, no accidentals. Bam, we get a D natural, but then immediately after a D flat. So I haven't gone over this, we'll go over this probably next class, but so you can, I don't wanna say ignore that natural, but it just means we're not changing key. We're just visiting another key, but we're not changing key because that D flat immediately comes back. The subject returns in A flat major. So we're still in A flat major. Now watch, the D natural returns and this time it stays. So what key would that hint at? That would hint at E flat major. Now what we need to confirm that is a cadence, and we get that cadence right here. There's a B flat 7 and an E flat. You can't be in a new key unless you cadence first, and usually that cadence is an authentic cadence, 5-1. So this is B flat 7 going to E flat, so now we're in the key of E flat major. Now I'm going to keep looking for, there's that D natural still. Oh, how do I make that stupid thing go away? Okay, went away. So the D natural, now that we've cadenced in E flat, oh stupid, the D flat comes back. So we're like, Jimmy, where are we? Well, that is D flat, and E flat. That's an E flat 7, A flat. So now we've just cadenced back to A flat. Okay. And notice no accidentals there for that measure. And there we get the subject in A flat again. Okay, going along, still A flat, no accidentals. There's that D natural again. So we're thinking, okay, maybe we're going to E flat major again. But now we get E natural. And then we get the subject in F minor. So now we're looking for a cadence in F minor, and it occurs right here. There's an F minor chord. Right before the F minor chord, we get a 7 chord. So that is an authentic cadence, but it's not perfect because it goes 7-1, not 5-1. So here now we're in F minor. And there's the subject or answer, whatever we want to call it, in F minor again, okay? Just so you know, I'm not going to be that picky between subject and answer. I mostly want you to be able to just isolate the subject. Sometimes you might be like, wait, is that the answer or is that the subject again? Don't stress about that. I just want you to be able to see it and hear it and identify it. But don't, usually it's just subject followed by answer. But there might be times when you're like, wait, is that the subject again? Because it's on the same notes. Don't stress about it. So we're in F minor there, we cadence. Then that E flat comes back. There's the E natural again. There's another cadence in F minor. So I'm not going to change key because C7, C major 7, F minor. Now we're in F minor, and take a look. The next statement is in B flat minor. And right before B flat minor, we get the 7 of B flat minor. There's that A natural, C, E flat, okay? So this is kind of a quick cadence in B flat minor. I'm gonna move that, why can't I move that? Oh well, you can, you heard me say it. So B flat minor. Then we go, moving along. There's that A natural again for B flat minor, so we're still in B flat minor. A natural again, A natural again. Cadence again in B flat minor. There's the subject again in B flat minor. This time now, it looks like the A naturals are gone. Okay, so we're probably moving somewhere else. Where might we be moving to? Well, that's kind of like G flat territory, but then the A natural is back and another cadence on B flat minor. So I'm just going to leave us in B flat minor. Now here we go. What? G natural? What the Jimmy? Oh, well, G natural, that would indicate there's an E flat 7 going back to A flat. And then D natural to E flat. So we're kind of just cycling through. Again, I'll teach you this terminology on Thursday. But my point is we're not landing on any one key for any period. There's a D flat, D natural. Cadence again on E flat major. I guess I'll probably go ahead and state that one, because it is a strong cadence. If we listen to the piece, you'd hear that that's a decent cadence. Bum, bum, bum. That's a strong 5-5-1. Okay, much stronger than the cadences over here. But then immediately after we cadence, there's an E-flat 7 arpeggio, followed by an A-flat major cadence right there. So immediately we go back to A-flat major, and we get the subject in A-flat major. Oh, now there's a G-flat. What a jimmy. Well, it's taking us to D-flat, but the G-flat doesn't stay. A-natural is back. Remember, A-natural takes us to B-flat minor, but the A-natural doesn't stay. So he's just kind of visiting keys and then quickly moving on. Okay, so for the most part, he's basically staying in A-flat major, even though he's hinting at other keys. And we're going on, we're going on. All of this is A-flat major. There's an E-natural, we said, that hinted to F minor. Then these two pitches are going to hint to C minor, but then nothing consistently, no accidentals consistently stick around. There we get the subject again in kind of this A-flat major type. You know, notice all those pitches are in A-flat major. G-flat is back again, but then where? Right away, G-natural is back. E-natural leads us to the F minor, but then E-natural is immediately back, right? Where's the E? Right there. E-flat is back, E-flat is back. So again, it doesn't stick around. And this whole bottom row, notice, we stay in A-flat major. So again, even though I want to be clear, we visit lots of other keys, we don't, none of them stay around long enough, and we don't hear the subject initiated in a set key, no strong cadences. You know, again, some of these you could make an argument for, like, oh, we cadence in F minor here. Yes, but right away it changes and we don't hear the subject in F minor. So if I go back and we do our full complete harmonic analysis, A flat, E flat, A flat, which in Roman numerals is 1-5-1. Then we have F minor, B flat minor, okay, so that's going to be 6-2. 1-5-1, 6-2. After B flat minor, we go to E flat, 6-2-5. 5 should lead us back to 1, A flat. Then from A flat, we visited lots of other keys, but I think we basically stay in A flat to the end. Okay, so our overall harmonic structure, I'm going to go ahead and write that up here. Harmonic form, we'll call it, is 1-5-1, 6-2-5-1. There's the overall harmonic form of the entire piece. Notice that even the form, the harmonic form, follows, what's the magic word? Functional harmony. 1-5-1, 6-2-5-1. That won't always be the case, but it usually is. 90% of the time it'll follow functional harmony. The other thing to notice is that in the Baroque period, they would, when they change key, it's usually only changing one sharp or flat. So that's 4 flats to 3 flats to 4 flats. F minor is the, what's the term again? It is the relative, so it's the same key signature. Then going to the 2, we add a flat. Now here's the one time it breaks that rule. From B flat minor to E flat major, we lose 2 flats. But B flat minor is the minor 5 of E flat, so they're still related by a fifth. That role and that power of the fifth is everywhere in this piece. Okay, so that's what your assignment is to do with the C minor fugue. We will talk a little bit about it on Thursday, but you won't have much class time on Thursday. So I'm hoping you use your class time today. You probably will have some homework. I'll be available to answer any questions on Thursday. That's why I'm not having it due Thursday, but I won't really give you much time on Thursday to work on it. And I think that's it. Done.